لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لا شريك.
بسم الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to your show, Philosophy of Hajj. I'm your host, Khalil Amonette. And of course, we're joined by our eminent professor, Muhammad Naim Saie. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome, thank you for being with us. In the last episode, we were just talking about the importance of remembering the Prophet's story, not only, and remembering the sites where they actually happen and how that can be of great benefit for Hajjaj to visit these sites and to see where these events actually happened. But also, and we left off with a really great story about how one of the companions just wanted to be the Prophet's doorman to ask something of him. The Prophet knew he wanted to ask something of him, and it was just that he be among him, with him in paradise. And so I think that's like not only a great point is not to only remember these places and remember these events, but also to obey the Prophet's teachings also. Yes. Can we talk a little about that?
JazakAllah khair. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا ومحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيه ورسوله اللهم نحمدك حمد يوافي نعمك ويدفع نقمك ويكافئ مزيدك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك لك الحمد ربنا اللهم نحمدك حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه حمدا لا جزاء لقائله إلا رضاك يا رب العالمين اللهم لك الحمد وإليك المشتكى وأنت المستعان وبك المستغاث وعليك تكلان ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم اللهم سهل الأمر على حجاج بيتك الحرام تقبل منهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اصفر عبادك الصالحين وعبادك المجاهدين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها يا رب العالمين فرج الكرب عنا وعن المكروبين ونفس الهم عنا وعن المهمومين اللهم إنا نجعلك في نحور الظالمين اللهم شتت شملهم وفرغ جمعهم واجعل دائرة السوء عليهم إنك أنت العزيز القوي المتين إنهم يمكرون مكرا وتمكر مكرا يا رب العالمين اللهم نسألك أن تمكر بهم وأن تحيط بهم إنك أنت الجبار القوي المتين آمين اللهم آمين. It is very amazing where we are sitting right now. We are sitting here to talk about the Hajj, where some people are very blessed by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, taking their place and their road. Some people are driving. Some people are flying. Some people are maybe sailing. All of them going to one place, toward one point, to fulfill the request and the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those. I've been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to inspire these people to remember us in their dua, inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah.
Maybe next year, inshallah, we'll be together, inshallah.
Inshallah
ta'ala. So we're talking about, maybe the last episode, about this sahaba, how they were understanding the real meaning of following the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. How they were understanding the real meaning of obeying the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. They cannot separate because of their very high standard of understanding between obeying, following, and loving the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. All has to come together. The physical proof, the spiritual proof, the emotional evidence, everything in your mind, in your time of good, maybe, circumstances, time of your bad circumstances, in difficulties, in hardship, in richness, poverty, you have to reflect, you have to announce, you have to prove that you are a real followers of the Prophet So the Sahaba, they were doing this, all these meanings. And till one of those disbelievers at that time, before he became Muslims, Abu Sufyan, in the Hudaybiyah treaty, because at that time they were blocked by going to Makkah al-Mukarramah. So as you know, they make Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Hudaybiyah treaty at that time, so they could be allowing to have their Umrah next year. So they wrote this treaty. But one of the very remarkable maybe things did take a place in this event. When Abu Sufyan was witnessing and watching the Sahaba, how they used to treat the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At that time, they were not maybe the upper, because they cannot continue their trip to Makkah Mukarramah. But even though they were acting as a real Sahaba, as a real followers, and Abu Sufyan was amazed by the way the Sahaba were treating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, among his what he said, whatever he says, they obey. Whatever he points to, they will listen. And over alayhi wasalam, he made wudu. They come, they rush to take part of what had been left over from his water, of his wudu. They were sometimes racing each other, who's going to take part of the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, as a part of the water he was using, alayhi wasalam. And to, if he doing anything, he will just take any part of him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And will come, when we talk about the way he was shaving his head, alayhi wasalam, and his hair, how he disputed his hair. And he gave a part of it to one of the Sahaba, Abu Talha, to dispute it among the Sahaba. Because the Prophet, he was reacting and acting, alayhi wasalam, as a justness Prophet, not just as a human being, and a prophet at the same time. So he knows how to please someone who is showing his interest in showing his love.
Appreciation and love.
Yes,
for them,
yes. Alayhi salatu wasalam. So he was acting with the Sahaba the same way that they were acting to him, sallallahu alayhi wasalam.
He was reacting to them,
sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So that way we'll know that when he was shaving his head in the day of the Dhul Hijjah, he ordered Sayyidina Abu Talha al-Ansari to dispute his hair among the Sahaba. Because he knows that they would love to have part of his hair, alayhi wasalam. And we'll talk about this in this episode later on, inshallah ta'ala.
Okay.
So the Sahaba, they were showing how much they love in an emotional way, in physical way.
Okay.
They were following, obeying, and expressing their love. One of the very important things in a human being's nature to enhance his relationship with anyone, like enhancing his relationship with his wife, his children, maybe his student, his maybe professor, with anyone, he has a relationship with him. Trust, love, respect, and expressing his feelings toward him. Suppose that you are a married person, but you are a very dry person. You are a non-romantic person. You don't express your love. You don't express your appreciation to what your wife is cooking for you or preparing for you. That will kill the love. That will bury the love. Will maybe minimize this kind of strong relationship between you and your wife.
So even if it's there, the person, even if the love is there, they need to show it in more outward way. Even, you know, that maybe they knew they loved the Prophet, but they were eager to show it to him.
Exactly.
And he was happy to receive it and to give back to them.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was acting this way in all his life. If you remember, alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was praying in his masjid, then he turned himself, and then he turned his body to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and he said, Wallahi ya Mu'adhu, inni la uhibbuk. He started, alayhi salatu wasalam, expressing his love toward one of the Sahaba, because some people, they are very stingy, you know, and showing their love, their feelings. They wait some other people to do that. But Muslims, they take that from the Prophet alayhi wasalam. Start showing others that you love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, if anyone does love his brother for the sake, he should inform him about this. Man ahabba akhawfa liyu'alimhu. If you love someone for the sake of Allah, just inform him, tell him. Because that will strengthen your love, enhance your relationship between you and him. So that the Prophet, he was saying that, Wallahi Mu'adhu inni la uhibbuk, I swear by God, Mu'adh, that I love you. La ilaha illallah. So the Sahaba, they were acting like human beings, but they were taking this from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet, he was acting and reacting. This is a normal relationship, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from that part, the Sahaba, they know how to express their love toward the Prophet during his life, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and after his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, one time, one of the followers came to one of the Prophet, alayhi sallam, wife or servant, and she did bring something to show him. And she brought like a vase.
Yes.
And he was putting in that vase some of the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his beard alayhi wasallam, or from his head. I'm not remembering very well right now. And she said that this is in the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after he died alayhi wasallam. And she said that we put this to anyone who got sick or ill. We mix it with some water and we give it to him as a medication. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured him because of this. And they know at that time that who's curing the sick?
Not
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this high understanding of this very special meanings. In our days right now, people, they don't do something like this. They believe in medication, right? They said, well, did you take your aspirin? Like I did say before I got to the program, I forgot my medicine, my medication.
Yes.
I have to take it.
Yes.
Because I have a belief that medication is very important for my health.
It is. I mean,
my health.
Science,
right?
Is a big part,
right,
of
right. But sometimes you forgot to separate between believing in the medication as a reason Allah created subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to have our belief in the medication itself. As if that we are forgetting that Allah is the one who cured us.
Who cured us, yes.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to remember all the time, Allah is the one who cures, who gives and takes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sahaba, they have this. They know that this is a cure from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the reason behind this cure, Allah has made it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this way. The same way the aspirin does make a cure for you, it's a reason Allah creates, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah created the hair of the Prophet والسلام, to make it as a reason of cure.
Okay, that's all the time we have, but that was a great reminder, Professor Saie, and we have to go to break now. Stay with us, please.
لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك.
Let's start from where they started. Who are they? The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they started learning the religion of Islam, they started with the aqidah, the belief system, faith. Brothers and sisters in Islam, dear viewers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spent 13 years in Mecca teaching that generation the belief system, the aqidah. Aisha radiallahu anha confirms this by saying, the first things which were revealed from the Quran was matters of aqidah. Who is Allah? Jannah, paradise and hell. Jundub ibn Abdullah al-Bajali, may Allah be pleased with him, said, we learned the belief system, we learned the iman, we learned the aqidah, then we learned the Quran, then we learned the Quran. Brothers and sisters in Islam, nowadays, a lot of our cultural practices, a lot of our societal norms are against our belief system. And the reason why we're falling into this, because we did not start from where they started. Join me, Karim Abu Zaid, twice a week on Huda TV screen with the new edition, Aqeedah Matters. See you then. Mm-hmm.
لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with us. And Professor Saie, we left off. You're talking about how the Prophet's hair, when put into water, was used as a sort of a cure for an illness. But it was, they knew it wasn't just because it was the Prophet's hair, but it was because Allah made it a cure. Can we pick up a little bit?
Yes, this is the very important point, just to make it very clear. The Sahaba at that time, because the Sahaba, they are the best one to understand what Allah wants, what they should believe in. I believe that Allah is the one who cures subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He loves His Prophet, alayhi wasalam, He makes very special status for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, till that part of his hair could be a cure. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a part of His cure subhanahu wa ta'ala as a reason to appear to you in a shape of aspirin, or maybe ibuprofen, or maybe Tylenol, or maybe to do like this, maybe surgery. But who is going to cure you? Who's the cure? Subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And who gave people the information and the knowledge to
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who made the Prophet Prophet, alayhi wasalam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to remember all the time to refer the real things happening in our life to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we respect this, can, as we said, these remarks, because Allah wants us to respect this subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to obey Him, to love Him, to respect Him, we are doing that for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, the Sahaba, they were not going beyond the line. They know what is the line they should stick to, and that the way we're doing, radiallahu anhu wa ardahum. Another story. One time, one of the very authentic story, or one bring it for the program is very authentic story, inshallah. We don't bring like weak story or non-authentic. Another authentic story, when one of the Sahaba, he was looking at the Prophet, he was gifted a very special dress. At that time, the Sahabi, he said, Ya Rasulullah, give it to me. And he knows that if he asks anything from what the Prophet is owning, alayhi salam, he will not hesitate to bring it, to give it to someone who has asked for. So the Prophet immediately, he took off that dress and gave it to the Sahabi. And he took it. After the Prophet left this gathering, one of the Sahaba said to this man, oh, he did ask the Prophet to give you his dress and he has nothing but this dress. He doesn't have anything else. He said, I know, but I want this dress for a special reason. What the special reason? He put in his will, when I died, this authentic story, when I die, put in his will, put this dress on my grave. Because that dress was for the Prophet, alayhi wasalam. So may Allah have mercy on him, because he's loved with the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And they did. They put in his grave this dress being given by the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. More than that, after he passed away, alayhi wasalam, one of the Sahaba, his name is Wathila ibn al-Asqa. This is a very authentic story too. He was visiting someone from the followers. He was on his bed, about just to leave this life. He was in the sickness, death maybe, at that time. So that follower took the hand of Wathila ibn al-Asqa, the Sahabi, and he took his hand and left, released his hand, and they started to wipe his face by his hand. And see, because this is the hand, it did make a covenant with the Prophet ﷺ, bay'ah. So he did take the hand of the Wathi, because he did touch the hand of the Prophet ﷺ. He did make mubay'ah to the Prophet ﷺ. So the meaning of mubay'ah means he was very special Sahabi. And he was very blessed to have the touch of the Prophet hand, alayhi salatu wasalam. And we remember all of us, this very authentic story too. They were in the Battle of Uhud. And the Prophet, alayhi salam, he was trying to organize the line of the Sahaba. They were like soldiers preparing for themselves for the battle of Uhud. So one of the Sahaba, he was like coming forward a little bit in his body. So the Prophet used to make the line straight, the same way in the prayer, the same way in the battlefield. So in his little maybe whip, he hit that person, that Sahabi, too. step back a little bit, just to make the line very, very straight. Mm. He said, Ya Rasulullah, you hit me and you hurt me. لَقَدْ أَوْجَعْتَنِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Oh, really? He said, yes. What do you want? He said, Al-Qisas. I have to take my
do right or
what?
Do right or yani.
Yes, I have to take my right. Yes. The same way you hit me, I have to hit you. This is what mean qisas here. All right. He said, go ahead, do it. The Prophet said to the Sahabi, hack. This is myself. Take your right. Hit me the same way I hit you. He said, no. Because you hit me when I have a naked belly. He was not having anything on his upper part of his body. Mm. He said, you hit me while my belly was naked. So he was asking the Prophet to take his dress up a little bit, so he's able to hit the Prophet ﷺ the same way he was being hit by the Prophet ﷺ. When the Prophet did that, he take his dress up a little bit, the Sahabi just put himself, his body, and his face on the belly of the Prophet, and he kissed the belly of the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, why are you doing this? Because I want, Ya Rasulullah, to be the last thing in my life that my body to touch your body. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it did. This Sahabi got killed in this battle. And he said, I want just to be the last thing in my life that my body to touch your body. This is the way the Sahabi were loving the Prophet. They were loving in actions. You see, he was expressing his feelings, his emotional feelings, but he was going to the battlefield to prove that he is the follower, the real follower of the Prophet. This is what we need today. We need our Muslim Ummah to prove their love toward the Prophet in actions, in feelings, in emotional way, in physical way, in everything in their life. That everyone is walking in this life. In any field, he can tell everyone very clearly, oh, this is the follower of the Prophet.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's how gracious the Prophet was. He was the leader, he was the Prophet, everyone respects him. You know, and to have this person say, you know, I want to hit you. Of course, he didn't hit him. You know, he's actually trying to show his love to the Prophet. But, you know, that's a very, very beautiful example of how the Prophet's character.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the bottom line, inshallah ta'ala, I would like just to recommend and insist on the importance of keeping this memory and this remarkable event and places and spot in our Muslim history, to keep it in our Muslim's mind, not just to take the symbolic meanings of it in its spot, but to transfer this symbolic meaning to our life, so we can activate it, we can utilize it, we can use it, inshallah ta'ala, to prove that we got the meanings, we understood the whole issue about having this memory in our practical life, inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah.
So we could, inshallah, transfer our love to the Prophet, transfer our love to the Al-Kaaba, to every place we are going to visit, inshallah ta'ala, in our practical life, to be like a Hajj in everywhere, to be the Prophet, followers in everywhere, inshallah ta'ala. So that will transfer the real meanings of these beautiful places and very important places into our life, taken from your heart, activate your mind, you're physically, you are in that spot, in that field, and that will get the benefit, inshallah ta'ala, at the most to every Muslim, inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah. What are some examples, I mean, I don't like to bring up negatives, but what are some examples of over-reverence towards the Prophet, perhaps where sort of like worship or something? I mean, how can we just keep safe on that side?
Well, as we said, this is the, first of all, Muslim scholars' duties, responsibilities, to make a very clear awareness about these issues and to enhance the people's knowledge that this is the Islamic law point of view in this regard. You love, you respect, but you don't go beyond this. And you remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is doing everything.
He's
the powerful subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who gives and takes and cure. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't worship anyone else. But as I said, you put it in it's a frame, an Islamic law frame. And this is the many problems in our life because we have taken our Islamic law frame out of our life. We put sometimes our own thought, maybe our own ideas, our own ideologies, sometimes maybe our own culture or maybe habit. No. Ask Muslim scholars, ask Muslim jurists, what is the stand on this regard? What is the view? If you just go to the books, Muslim scholars' books, long time ago, till this moment, they cannot just go beyond this. When the jurist, Muslim jurist, will answer a question, he'll put everything in its place, inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah.
Is it lawful to make tawaf around his place of born, alayhi salam? No. It's unlawful. It's forbidden. It's very clear. Is it good to keep it to remember? It's good to keep it and remember. So they have this differentiation. But this is Muslim scholars' duties. And second, we have to enlighten and remind our maybe Muslims in general, ordinary people from different professions. You should keep it up to the Muslim scholars and put it within the frame of the Islamic law, inshallah ta'ala.
Because they're the inheritors of the Prophet's message, inshallah. And that's all the time we have. I'd like to thank you, Professor Saie, for that beautiful knowledge and wisdom you shared with us. And that's all the time we have. Please join us another time for Philosophy of Hajj. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك.